been fantastic programs all week here at the Y about this fascinating topic of genius. But this is the most interesting topic to me, because of course as a psychiatrist, you know, it's interesting to think about the fact that we revere genius. And at the same time, we still tremendously stigmatize illness. Yet, if you take a look at some of the most amazing geniuses of all time, many of them were really quite ill or definitely struggled with illness. I have a series here actually that I do called Psychobiography, where I look at historic icons, genius icons, and what was amazing to me as I started to do this over the last couple of years is how many of them struggled with illness. Hemingway, Lincoln, Dickinson, Darwin, Van Gogh, Pollock, I mean, pretty much everybody that I wanted to cover really has struggled with illness. And so that has made me think increasingly about this topic. And so I'm bringing tonight to you a wonderful panel to discuss what is still a really murky area, disagreed about inside the field and outside. So I hope we'll have a lively and interesting discussion about it. Please welcome my panel. I think if you can find your seats, we're gonna give you the Genius Award because we made it challenging. Sorry about that. Okay, so. Starting on my right here, we have Dr. James Kaufman. He's a professor of educational psychology at the School of Education at the University of Connecticut, an internationally recognized leader in the field of creativity. He's the author and editor of more than 30 books, including Creativity 101 and the Cambridge Handbook of Creativity, and more than 200 papers on the topic. He's the past president of the American Psychological Association's Division 10, which is devoted to creativity and aesthetics. Next to him, please welcome Dr. Dean Simonton, who is the Distinguished Professor of Psychology at the University of California, Davis. His approximately 500 publications focus on various aspects of genius, creativity, and leadership. And he recently edited the Wiley Handbook of Genius, the very first handbook devoted to that subject. And at the end, please welcome Sylvia Nasar. She was an economics correspondent for the New York Times. She holds an endowed chair at Columbia's Graduate School of Journalism and wrote two award-winning books about geniuses, A Beautiful Mind, the biography of mathematician John Nash, and Grand Pursuit, the story of economic genius. So it's wonderful to have you here. Thank you. So this concept that genius is intermingled, let's say, with madness is actually not a new one, right? Aristotle said, every great genius has an admixture of madness. So it's something that was seen long, long, long ago. I think romanticized, let's say, over the many, many years, particularly at the time of Lord Byron, romanticized as something that seemed, therefore, maybe it fit. And going forward, I think people who have accomplished something tremendous, there's always sort of looking at, is there another side to them? Let's start, since this concept has been around. We keep changing what the concept of genius means. So if each of you could speak a little bit to what you think about when you think about that. What does genius actually mean?
I'm going to defer to Dean to the phone since he's Mr. Genius.
Okay. I've written a book called Genius 101, so it's kind of the everything you need to know about genius and probably a lot of things you don't want to know. But there's actually multiple definitions of genius. Usually when we think of genius in this context, the mental illness context, we're talking about people who have made an incredibly phenomenal and lasting contribution to some socially valued domain. They're great artists, they're great scientists. I would even include political leaders. You mentioned Abraham Lincoln sometime. I would consider Abraham Lincoln a genius in politics. So that's one definition, and that's the one that's usually linked with this issue of madness. And then another definition, which I'm sure you all heard, and this is actually in the dictionary, is someone who has a very high IQ. In the American Heritage Dictionary, it actually says a specific number, 140. So if you're 139, my condolences. You don't pass, even though it's a totally arbitrary number, and there's actually a historical reason for that. So that's another definition. And that also has an interesting relationship with the psychopathology issue as well, because some people who are extremely bright may suffer for that, consequences of that, socially, for example, in their development. And then the third definition is the sort of the exceptional performance definition, and particularly prodigious performance, child prodigies, for example, someone who is doing something at an incredibly young age, and we call them, you know, childhood geniuses, or I don't particularly like that term, because a lot of these people, it puts a lot of pressure on them, and then they end up, you know, suffering the consequences later on. We have a local genius at Davis who at 9 years old is already attending college classes and has his own reality show. Sad. So that's the third definition for me.
James, what about how does creativity fit into the definition of genius?
So now what I focus on is creativity, and I see it as kind of a developmental perspective where we start with mini C, and this is not genius, but it's the first path way to genius. And it's the creativity inherent in the learning process, which can grow to little C or everyday creativity. And again, we all can do this. At this point, it gets to pro C or expert level creativity. And this is where I see the pinnacle of what we can do while we are alive. Where big C or genius creativity to me is what we find out 100 years hence, what has lasted. And I mean, just yesterday I was looking up somebody who, there was a letter on eBay that was up for sale, Peter Gerald. I look him up and he was a playwright, and it has this point that he was a superstar during his day, and now nothing he's done is ever performed. Mm-hmm. And that you have this thing where you know, as people are living, there is pro C. And what becomes big C, what becomes genius, and what just becomes footnotes.
So you're saying it's based on remembering them, but remembering them may be very influenced by cultural, I mean, by not just them and even what they came
Absolutely.
Up with, but you're saying to you it's dependent on culturally how they were received, what they were able to implement, and how it's remembered.
And as well as the current culture and how it would remember or interpret or value their contributions.
Mm-hmm. John Nash is certainly remembered as, or he's still living, he is considered a genius. Do you think that he thinks about IQ as being instrumental, creativity as being instrumental?
Well, I think lots and lots of people are very, very smart, but very few people do monumental things, and even fewer do several monumental things. So I think that I agree that what one creates is really central. I also think that I was thinking about why it is that when we talk about genius, we usually think about a Michelangelo or a Shakespeare. We usually think about artistic genius or scientific genius. We rarely call J.P. Morgan or John D. Rockefeller or geniuses, or Abraham Lincoln, so there's also an element of mystery of, I don't know how, I can't even imagine how he did this or she did this. And that is one of the things that even other mathematicians who are in the fields in which John Nash worked, that was a great element in his, in his fame and notoriety among his peers.
Clearly, he had a high IQ. Do we know how high, did he know how high his IQ was?
I may be conflating it with something else, but I want to say that his IQ was 156.
Sounds good.
Which
it's over 140.
which, I mean, I'm sure that many people in this audience have an IQ of 156. It's not that unusual.
It's pretty unusual, but it's pretty unusual. And actually, many of the artists that we talk about as being geniuses actually didn't have any, wouldn't have met your criteria of 140.
Oh, yeah. I mean, a lot of them don't have high IQs. And part of that is the problem with the IQ test is that it measures pretty much analytic mm-hmm. intelligence mm-hmm. and leaves out a lot of stuff that's absolutely essential for being an artist, you know, spatial, visual thinking, mm-hmm. imagination.
And the imagination and the creativity aspect yeah. of it.
And again, I mean, IQ tests don't claim to measure that. I yeah. mean, IQ tests claim to measure this, and I think they measure this reasonably well, but the world exists here, and mm-hmm. how do we measure this?
Right. I mean,
so let's turn to the issue of this overlap between genius and illness. Clearly, I think none of us would say, and nobody really is saying, that you are required to be ill to be a genius. Mm-hmm. but there do seem to be a surprisingly high number of people who we consider to be geniuses having illness as compared with the population of non-geniuses having illness. So actually, Dean, this is an area that you've
Well, first of all, can I say this is a much more complicated issue than a lot of people tend to think. When we talk about genius, we're really talking about a quantitative thing. I mean, some people, I mean, you implied this, you know, the pro C, and then you have the big C, but big C varies.
Right.
I mean, you know, Michelangelo, everybody knows about, but you know, he had a lot of Italian contemporaries. It was a great era in Italian Renaissance art, and I bet you can't name probably can't name any of his contemporaries besides Leonardo da Vinci.
Ninja Turtles, you can name Donatello.
One more. But Donatello was not his contemporary, he was earlier.
He was also a turtle.
But so there's degrees in genius from just those stellar ones, the ones that define the field, like the Michelangelos and Beethovens and so forth. And then psychopathology is a dimensional variable too. You can have degrees of symptoms, you know. You may be depressed a lot, depressed a little bit. You may have big depressions where you can't get out of bed, and small depressions where you just kind of mope around. So you have to take in those quantitative things as well. And a lot of the mental illness that we're talking about when we talk about creative genius, for example, we're really talking about subclinical levels of, because these people are still able to do their work. They're just not very happy about it all the time.
Right. So the question is, right, how are we defining illness?
Yeah.
The DSM-5, the Diagnostic Manual for Psychiatry, would say that the symptoms, for the most part, should rise to the level of interfering with your functioning.
Right.
But if we're saying you're a genius, we seem to be implying that you are certainly functioning. Mm-hmm. So that would imply that people on, let's say, the sickest end of the curve would not really be able to come up with, put together the thoughts and be able to do the work with those thoughts to be a genius. But there does seem to be something about the middle of that U-shaped curve, the people who have some illness, not a tremendous amount of illness. And yet, you know, we have John Nash over here who doesn't seem to fit that model.
Well, I was actually, by pure happenstance, speaking with an epidemiologist today. And this is how he put it. He said, well, a lot of people suffer from major mental illnesses, meaning major depression, bipolar, or schizophrenia. Very few people are geniuses. Very few geniuses have major mental illnesses. But those who do, it's almost exclusively bipolar.
Hmm.
Okay. Now, this may be oversimplified or it may be outdated. I don't know. But in John Nash's case, there were several things that that made it possible for him to achieve an extraordinary status before, and one of them was that he didn't get sick until he was 30 years old. He was odd. He was peculiar, although I don't know that he was more odd than many mathematicians or scientists. But he didn't get sick until he was 30 years old, by which time he had already, I mean, the stuff that he did for the Nobel, as almost every mathematician who I interviewed said, that was the most trivial thing he ever did. Okay, but he, so he did great things in pure mathematics. He also, and the fact that he got sick so late at age 30 also helps to explain why he recovered, because your chances of recovering from chronic schizophrenia after 30 years are higher if you're a man, if you have late onset, and if you have paranoid schizophrenia.
Yeah. That would actually fit the model of the U-shaped curve, right? Because while he presented as very ill at 30, he probably had some earlier symptoms that weren't defined as, you know, the intense illness that may have actually, you know, that would fit this model of having unusual thoughts earlier.
You know, I have to say, you know vastly more than I do about this, but I feel that to call someone ill, there has to be a functional breakdown. And the fact is that that lots of people are strange, right? Many of us are strange, and yet we can do what we need to do or what we want to do very, very well, which was the case with
right.
Nash.
Right.
He may have been peculiar, but he was very, very good at eliciting what the most interesting problems were, the problems most likely to give you lasting fame. He was
so he knew how to ask the right questions.
He knew how to ask the right questions of the right people. He knew how to get help from other people. Anyway,
right. I would say that's a feature of genius, right? The person who thinks. I mean, part of it isn't just thinking of the solution, right? It's thinking of the question,
thinking
of the unusual question. So let's talk about a little bit about what illnesses do seem to, in some way, promote the likelihood of whether it's, you know, unusual thoughts, what we would call divergent thoughts, which is often thought of as creativity in a way, right?
And certainly divergent thinking is one element of creativity. So just that there is... The way that it's sometimes called is shared latent inhibition, where there are some shared things that are true of both creativity and madness, such as the ability to think very divergently, or the ability to not always have a great filter of not saying whatever random thing is coming out of your mouth from your brain, but that there are other things that moderate it. So intelligence, for example, is one of them, that the higher you are in intelligence, obviously there are exceptions, the more that you can moderate and take these questionable abilities and turn them into more creative output than illness. This is a lot of Shelley Carson's work.
So what illnesses are we really talking about here that increase your likelihood of having divergent thoughts?
To answer that question, we have to really first introduce the very important empirical fact that the illness, how to phrase this, the favorite illness depends on your area of creativity.
Okay,
so
yes.
There's some areas where, and this is not just in like histometric research or psychometric research, like for example, people who are creative in the mathematical sciences, they tend to be more on the autism spectrum.
Or disagreeable or hostile.
Yeah, and you know, very, very focused and what have, are you talking about me?
No.
Actually,
but then you get in the artistic end, and you're more likely to have some kind of affective disorders. You know, like you mentioned, bipolar or, you know, plain ordinary depression, suicidal depression. So, and you notice if you think about it, those actually can make contributions to the form of creativity that you're engaged in. If you're engaged in the mathematical sciences, where you have to be very, very precise and focused on a very narrow thing, you're working on a very long, elaborate proof, it's really useful to be autistic. On the other hand, if you're dealing with, you know, you're a poet, and you're writing very, very emotional, maybe confessional poetry, you got to have something to write about. And it's nice to have personal experiences with depression and those kinds of things. So that's why there is a very intimate connection between the type of mental illness and the area of creativity that you're active in.
So in the arts, you're more likely to see someone with bipolar disorder or depressive disorder, or you can show the audience your tie.
Oh, yeah. This is, you know, answer. Everybody's seen this.
The Scream.
Yeah, The Scream. And he definitely was.
Tremendous anxiety, panic, fear.
Yeah.
But in the sciences, we're talking about other kinds of things. And when we talk about politicians or great leaders.
Well, it's interesting. There's some recent research on that that suggests that great leaders may be sociopaths. Won't name names.
Okay.
Because, you know, it's election year next year, but just think about it.
Well, it makes sense if you, you need someone who is willing to take risk, is willing to break the rules, mm-hmm. Is willing to, and in fact, may even be thrive off of risk, right? Mm-hmm. Can make impulsive decisions. And isn't thinking too hard about how each individual feels about those decisions that they're making. So that is a great segue because, you know, so to some degree, we know that there's a genetic component to mental illnesses. Not all of them the same, but certainly in bipolar disorder, in major depression, in schizophrenia, we know that there's a genetic component. We don't necessarily know that genius runs in families, but high creativity, there is some, right, that relatives of, well, I don't know, let me ask you that. Is there anything to suggest that creativity, creative fields run in families?
I think that there's more evidence for intelligence being genetic than creativity.
I mean, that's the thing. Even though we like to think of intelligence and creativity as being independent, they really are correlated. It's really hard to be really creative if you're not intelligent. I was going to say something else. And so that kind of conflates things, kind of confounds things. But there are some studies. Let me just say there are some studies that suggest that creativity does not necessarily run in families. Mm-hmm. There's been some interesting behavioral genetic studies that suggests that creativity may be something that's called emergenic. It has to be configurational. You have a particular mix of things, and they all have to be there. And if you're missing one component, you're not going to be creative.
Or at least not creative genius.
At least not a creative genius, okay? So, I mean, we still need to do more research on this. I mean, part of the problem, of course, what we really need to do is do a lot of standard behavior genetic studies using twins.
Yes.
Identical twins are rare, and geniuses are rare, and finding identical twin geniuses is...
Needle in a haystack.
Has there ever been any identical twin geniuses?
It's very rare. One example is kind of interesting. It's two columnists that did the personnel. Dear Abby,
yes.
And what was her sister?
Right.
Yeah, Anne Rand. Yeah. Right. They were twins.
Identical twins.
Were they geniuses?
Yeah.
Well, at what they did.
Amazing.
I mean, the audience could name them.
So if we're saying there's a genetic component to illness and to intelligence, but clearly that's not the whole megilla. So there's the environmental factor, the way you were brought up, and the cultural influences, and early life influences, and of course your comment about sociopathy made me think about the fact that, you know, people who may be wired to be risk takers and not terribly empathic, mm-hmm. If they're brought up in a wonderful environment, you know, may grow to be our best leaders. And if they're brought up in a traumatic and terrible environment, may grow up to be our best serial killers, you know? So what about the impact of early life on genius, on creativity, and on illness?
I'll take that because I have some studies just came out this year on that. One of the questions that is often raised about the mad genius thing is we do have lots of examples of geniuses that aren't mad. They don't even have any psychopathology, not even the most subclinical level. But there's also increased evidence that there's something else that's functioning in the same way, and that is developmental adversity. Having experiences early in childhood of losing one parent or both or some other kind of trauma, maybe tremendous economic ups and downs, racial or ethnic discrimination, religious discrimination. And I have a study coming out this year where I looked at a sample of eminent African Americans. There was 291. These are all people you should have heard of. I was hoping it was come out in February, but it didn't, because that's African History Month. But what I showed is that you get the same patterns as far as mental illness being associated with certain kinds of creativity and so forth, but it was moderated by whether or not they had tremendous adverse experiences in early childhood. Mm. So there was a trade-off between them. So if they had lots of those experiences, then they had no mental illness. If they had very little developmental adversity, then they had more proclivity towards mental illness. So it's sort of it's like taking the same function. It's trying to make you so you don't see the world like everybody else sees it. And if you're a member of a minority group, you don't need much help.
So in other words, it's so adverse or difficult for them that more adversity is too much adversity.
Right. In fact, one thing we found fascinating is we're looking at African-American artists, and we just were blown away because there's absolutely no example of a major African-American artist who committed suicide. And as you know, that's unheard of
amongst the artist
culture artists.
Michael Jackson?
Huh?
Well,
really? I don't know if Michael Jackson committed suicide. I think he's just...
I was just thinking about something related, which is a friend of mine who was a mathematician and married to a mathematician, and whose daughter was about to go off to college, was asking why is it that so few mathematical geniuses are women? Okay, and from her own experience of observing her daughter and friends, her hypothesis was that boys, the kind of boys that were like John Nash, were indifferent to what other people thought of them, okay? And so, went their own way and also weren't distracted by the need to conform socially, whereas her daughter and her daughter's friends were much more sensitive to what other people thought, mm-hmm. whether that's inborn to men and women, or whether that's a product of upbringing, who knows?
There's empirical evidence for what you just said.
Oh.
There was a study done at UC Berkeley of eminent women mathematicians. It was specifically mm-hmm. focused on them. And because I was wondering how, and this is decades ago when they were even more rare.
Right.
And one of the things that was kind of interesting finding was that they tended not to be very feminine. They had no interest in teaching. And that's something that's often characteristic of male mathematicians. Like the Unabomber, he was a mathematician, had no interest in teaching whatsoever.
Uh-oh. Well, we've done that panel on evil genius. But in a way, along the same lines, the idea that illness that has you sort of less sensitive to what others think, less aware of what others are thinking, could confer an advantage in terms of being able to respond to whatever your own internal creative thought is. Mm-hmm. You look skeptical.
Yeah, I guess not, at least not for artists, who I would think there's some self-reflection, and there is evidence that too much rumination will lead to depression, and that poets are more likely to ruminate than other types of writers.
Right.
So I think it's very domain specific, not even artists, but the exact type of art, because other writers try to reach out in the humanity in others and reflect what everybody else feels, not just what they feel.
There's a fairly significant pot of poets who definitely have struggled with illness and depression.
Female poets.
Female poets.
Although it's important to note that that's just eminent. And again, there's this, I don't want to say confusion, but that between that line between genius and creativity, where this the Sylvia Plath effect says that among eminent writers, female poets are more likely to show signs of mental illness, but it's been interpreted to mean that creative people are more mentally ill, which isn't at all what it says.
What does it say?
That very specifically, among eminent writers, just among eminent writers, female poets are more likely to be mentally ill. And yet, you know, female journalists and novelists, we're doing pretty good.
You're all right.
Female journalists, you know, thumbs up.
Yeah.
So it's
But, you know, I wanted to ask you, the epidemiologist I was talking to today said that that you couldn't be mentally ill and a scientific genius at the same time. I just wanted to know, what are the facts? I mean, he was implying that you needed a sort of steady and persistent progress in order to produce in science. So we were talking about John von Neumann, for example, who made huge contributions to at least three. So what are the facts? Do you?
Well, I mean, first of all, scientists are at a disadvantage if they have mental illness in two ways. First of all, it's hard to learn to become a scientist. You have to spend a long time, you know, taking hard courses, the kind of courses we ended up dropping out of and becoming psych majors.
Lit majors.
You know, the calculus sequence and beyond and all this kind of stuff. And then once you get there, you've made it, you've gone through all the gatekeepers, and you finally have your degree and setting up your lab, the same thing that you just suggested, you have to turn out and be very systematic. You can't just all of a sudden lapse into some depression and let all of your lab animals die.
Although,
which would be depressing.
Marie Curie, you know, first woman to win the Nobel Prize, only woman to win two Nobel Prizes in two different areas, suffered terrible recurrent depressions. I mean, really making her at times marginally functional, from which she would obviously bounce back and be able to do her lab work in between, but clearly so. Charles Darwin clearly struggled with, you know, panic or some variety of terrible anxiety disorder. Doesn't seem to be.
But I think there's an answer to that. If you look at what Marie Curie did and what Darwin did, they try to do this thing where they keep themselves busy, you know. If you're depressed, then chin up and just keep on your mind to the wheel. And
right.
I mean, like Darwin, I mean, yes, he had those depressions, but he wrote four or five volume book on barnacles.
Yeah. That's enough to make you depressed.
I'm sure whenever he's depressed, he says, it's time to get to my barnacle study.
Right.
Yeah. It's also,
well, so is there something to be said then for the idea that one might be having what today we would call, you know, mental illness that we would say, you know, come to a psychiatrist, maybe you need medication, et cetera, and that being involved in the work and absorbed in the work has any kind of protective effect, helpful effect?
Yeah, I think so. John Nash produced some very, very good papers after he got sick. And when he could no longer do that, he hung out in the Princeton Library and studied philosophy, et cetera, et cetera. Now, he didn't produce anything then, but I think that it helped preserve his mental abilities until he actually was able to recover. Mm-hmm. So it makes a big difference. If, again, if you get sick at 30 and you have many years of disciplined engagement, your chances are better.
Yeah.
During those formative educative years.
I'd also love to see what the field's gonna look like in 150 years, where we have so much evidence right now of people blogging and everything out there that we can really analyze, and that when we look at geniuses, true geniuses, the way who were considered 100 years ago, mm-hmm. it's still limited evidence. Mm-hmm. And you can learn an incredible amount. I mean, there's an amazing amount that you can learn in terms of mentally ill or not mentally ill, or the level of mental illness. In terms of exact diagnoses, it starts to scare me a little bit.
So, you know, unfortunately, right, when we're looking at a lot of these people, we're retrospectively diagnosing, which is never an entirely fair thing to do, and not necessarily accurate. And your other point about who did we see as a genius and not, in other words, Marie Curie is a rare woman in the field because, of course, women weren't really supported or certainly not expected, if anything, you know, kept from being recognized, certainly. And you had, I mean, she fought tooth and nail to be recognized for her own work. So that is obviously much less the case today, and people can sort of create something and put it out there today in a way that, you know, really couldn't be done before. So we may see something very different start to emerge. But one thing that first of all, we haven't talked about all kinds of illness. Attention deficit disorder is a commonly diagnosed and ever-growing diagnosis in children. I think parents are often very upset to hear that, or kids are very frustrated, upset, feel like it might be limiting, and yet, again, there do seem to be a number of highly, highly accomplished people who feel that actually, in a way, it's been useful to them. Mm-hmm. I don't know if either of you have taken a look at that.
Two thoughts. One is that in the most recent review of ADHD and creativity, I read that it was more that the symptoms mirror each other than actual hardcore ADHD people having extreme creativity, but more that the symptoms, so to speak, of being extremely creative and being ADHD were similar. It's also interesting that if you take ADHD meds, it often will make you do better on intellectual tasks and a little worse on creative tasks, mm-hmm. which is a little scary. as someone who takes ADHD meds.
Doesn't seem to have hurt your creativity too much. Maybe even motivated your field of study. But
certainly hasn't hurt my productivity.
So that's actually an important point, right? You can have all the divergent, you know, amazing divergent thoughts you want, and if you can't bring it to fruition, then, you know, we don't count it. We will say you're a genius in your own mind.
And it gets back to that curve in the relationship because sometimes we have geniuses that are on the cusp of almost being on the decline end. Mm-hmm. I mean, the one person I was thinking about is Leonardo da Vinci. I don't know if you realize that he finished very few paintings.
Yes.
And very few sculptures.
Yes.
He would start something and then he would get distracted.
But what we don't know, because we actually just spoke about Leonardo earlier this week, is what we don't know is, right, did he, today we would be able to ask him the questions to understand, was he obsessional and he was so perfectionistic that he couldn't finish anything because it wouldn't be perfect? Was he such a procrastinator that he couldn't finish anything? Or had he solved the question? You know, his paintings, right, were a question, were something to be solved. And once he'd come up with the solution, it no longer interested him, which is why, right, even though we remember him mostly as an artist, he really was a mathematician, an architect, a physicist. He had military applications. He did the first anatomical drawings that we have. So he was a Renaissance genius.
But when you read his notebooks, his brain is all over the place. You know, he's looking at meteorology here. He says, "Oh, and here's a woman's womb," and you know, and here's.
I mean, this is true. This is true.
Battleship.
This is true.
I mean, this is true.
So he looks like someone with ADD.
Yeah.
And we wonder. Good thing we didn't have Ritalin then, because we did not have the Mona Lisa.
Or just so uber genius that it's exploding.
I mean,
how do you even put him on?
He was sort of on to the next thing and the next thing, and so it's hard retrospectively to say. I want to make sure that we get some audience questions in. And we do have a bunch here. Walter Isaacson, in an earlier talk tonight, mentioned the role of collaboration in genius. How does madness function within collaborations of genius? So for instance, are there examples of collaborations like Jobs and Wozniak? or of the founding fathers of this country, where you could talk about madness having been a factor.
Certainly, if we look at pro-C, not necessarily big C, but conflict about the task is good. Conflict because you don't like each other, not good. Mm-hmm. So if you're working with people you dislike, you'll get less done. If you're working with people who you disagree, you'll get more done.
Yeah, I mean, I feel awkward answering that question because I wrote a book review of that very book. Oh. Hasn't come out yet, because I thought it was very, very fascinating, just talking about all the collaborations, and you know, like the one you mentioned. But it's very interesting, if you look at those collaborations much more closely, they really more dovetail with each other. It's like each person is making up for something that the other person lacks. Mm-hmm. You know, like Jobs, he was the marketer. He's gonna take it out and get it produced and sell it. Where Wozniak says, "Wait a minute, I'm not done yet. I still want to, you know, work on it and get it, you know, fine tuned." And in effect, if it was up to him, then we wouldn't have had Apple computers. So those collaborate. You see the same thing at Intel. There were three guys at Intel, each of whom had a special virtue mm-hmm. that compensated for another person's vice. Mm-hmm.
Well, I was just thinking about Andrew Wiles and Fermat's Last Theorem and John Nash and something you did in partial differential equations, both of which involved recruiting a large number of other mathematicians to work on different parts of. Mm-hmm. I don't know what Andrew Wiles has a completely different personality from John Nash, and John Nash wasn't sick when he did that, but it's almost necessary. I mean, I think that someone like Gregory Perelman, who solved the Poincaré conjecture in isolation, that is almost almost never happens anymore because you need so many, you need to draw on so much in a field to do anything really new.
Mm-hmm. How do you, so this was a question that I was going to pose to you, so I'm glad somebody is. How do you treat a sick genius without killing his creativity? What is the parameter?
I'm not a therapist.
I was just saying.
Okay, all right. So, you know, obviously this is a hotly debated topic, and there are many people who would say, for instance, that if they have bipolar disorder, they don't want to take medication because they fear that it will squelch their creativity. You know, the issue is usually this: whether it really squelches creativity or not, we don't know really, and we don't know how much. But if somebody is non-functional because of their illness, then we do know that they won't be able to take whatever wonderful creative thoughts they have and really produce them. So that always, for the person who is treating someone who comes in and, you know, with that dilemma, I think that is sort of how at least I, as a therapist, would look at it, you know, that you have to be able to be functional in your life. And so we don't want to take away your creativity. We don't want to take away, you know, any ability for high and low, and you know, make you sort of, you know, monotone. But we do want to take the peaks and the really high peaks and the really low valleys out because they, you know, they destroy relationships. They destroy your ability to do your work actually and produce your work.
In fact, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Prinzhorn Museum. This was a museum that was put together, well, by a guy named Prinzhorn. Where he collected art by people who were institutionalized. These are people who could not lead normal lives. And they couldn't even be homeless persons. And with a few exceptions, and these exceptions all involve professional artists who went mentally ill, none of the stuff is good. It isn't good. In fact, it's kind of interesting. One of the proofs of that was established by Adolf Hitler, because what he tried to do is he took paintings from the Prinzhorn Museum and put them side by side modern paintings, like, you know, Klee and so forth, and Max Ernst, and said, "See, it's just the same thing. These people are mad. But if you look at them, I'm sorry, these people are much better than these people," you know. So they, when you go over the edge, and it's not good art.
And the studies have just looked, not in terms of genius, but just these schizophrenics and these people who are matched on every other thing, the people without schizophrenia almost always are more creative in terms of, you know, so.
But that's for schizophrenia, which unlike some of these other illnesses we're talking about, has real cognitive deficit. In other words, part of the illness is to impair thinking, really, in a significant way, to slow you down and make it difficult for you to emotionally connect. So
most studies of anyone with active, full-blown mental illness that who would be institutionalized?
Oh, well, that would be institutionalized, yes.
Whatever the diagnosis,
yes,
tends to score lower.
Yes.
Which, again, is an extreme.
Yes. But you certainly found when you looked at, for instance, people with bipolar disorder, that it certainly, for people in the arts,
right,
that seemed to be, for lack of better words, a plus.
They often exploit it.
Yes.
And in fact, in the depressed, you know, there's research showing, for example, that states of depression are associated with more realistic perception of the world. That's part of the reason why you're depressed. You see the world the way it really is. And your relationships and, you know, politics and all that. And so you see things that you don't like about the world, and it makes you depressed. And then you get out of it because you're bipolar. And then you get into this mag phase where you channel all that that wisdom, if you want to call it that, that you acquired.
Right, so you take that realism and you take the empathy that comes with being depressed, of really feeling what everybody else feels, and you can use that content when you're having many, many thoughts that are associated with, like, hypomania.
Yeah, and then you'll connect all these things together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was going to say that Kay Jamison, who,
yes,
wrote,
yeah, Touched by
a
Fire,
sort of seminal book about genius and madness called
Touched by Fire.
Touched by Fire, she is bipolar herself, and she takes lithium, and she's had an extraordinarily creative and productive career,
right,
as a consequence of controlling her symptoms.
But does she take just the right amount?
Well, I was going to say what I was going to say is that getting medication right, of course, is a possibility, but it's also hard. And a lot of what people object to has to do with being badly medicated.
You know, unfortunately, people can't stay hypomanic. If you could just stay this teeny little bit of manic, but that is not the way that it works. So no one stays hypomanic. And the fact is that most people who really are highly creative and then get treated do not report that they lost their creativity. I can't say nobody, but I could say most people say that they've retained their creativity, but now they can write, or they can paint, or they can, you know.
And just the Jamison book within the field of creativity is not necessarily valued at all.
Oh, I was going to ask you.
So this is a debated area.
Yes. As in both Andreasen and Jamison, who are the big names for the connection, their research is not particularly good.
You mean it's not... In other words, it's anecdotal and not.
I don't want to get into great detail because that would derail the rest of the thing.
Right.
But the stuff that convinces me there's some type of a link is the work that Dean does, not the stuff that they do. Because Dean's stuff is, to me, actually research, and it's empirical, and it's often quite brilliant. And he works alone, curiously.
Must be crazy.
But Jamison Andreasen's work, there are so many flaws, so many basic, obvious flaws, and you may disagree with me,
James wouldn't be the first to say that.
It's fingernails on chalkboard for some of us to hear that.
That's
proclaimed as the only stuff.
Well, one of the main problems is just trying to find adequate control groups.
Right.
I mean, that's the bottom line. For both her and for Andreasen.
I mean, it's and if they weren't saying the debate was closed, if they weren't saying, here, this is great research, I'd feel differently.
Right. I did want to ask you, you said before when we were talking that this is very controversial. Can you just explain what the controversy is about? Why is it? I mean, about this whole subject and why it's polarized.
I think part of it is just one of the things that's happened recently is there's a major movement called the positive psychology movement, and it wants to say that there are all these positive virtues that we all should have, and they all go together in nice, neat little packages. I've gotten many arguments with the founders of the positive psychology movement about this, because I don't think they come in nice, neat packages. So there are people who, you know, they're very nice and generous and good people, and they're good friends, and they do it. But they may not be very creative, and then this guy or gal is very creative, but they're assholes. Or whatever your favorite expression is. But they don't go together. In fact, it's interesting, there was one paper, I edited a special issue of a journal devoted to this, and one of the articles in there put it really nicely. It said they tended in positive psychology to see we have these strengths and we should emphasize these strengths and values and so forth. But they're really kind of two kinds of strengths. There's balanced strengths where you try to be good and have all the cardinal virtues. And then there's focal strength where you try to be the best person at that particular thing, whether it's mathematics or sports or whatever. And they are not necessarily consistent. Mm-hmm. You know, there's Howard Gardner talks about the Faustian bargain that great creative geniuses make. And that suggests, and you know, like Picasso, the people they picked up and crunched and threw to the ground on those way to his masterpieces, this long pile. You know, of course, they were all women too. Well, there were some men there too.
I mean, to me, creativity is an ability, and that you can be, you know, if everybody was more creative, the world would not be a better place. Because
yeah,
some people use
true.
Creativity for good, and some people use creativity to figure out how to scam people or, you know, hide the bodies better. I mean, it's kind of like intelligence or emotional intelligence. More of it would be good for you, but it wouldn't necessarily be good for the world. Mm. I think a lot of the debate is that, I mean, some of it's to focus. I think there's a lot of evidence that creativity is associated with many wonderful things. Post-traumatic growth and a lot of good stuff that's often swept under the rug. I think it's a complex issue. I think that a lot of it also is that you have the creativity researchers who do their stuff here, they publish in these journals, and you have the people who study mental illness and they study here and publish in their journals. And among the creativity people, there's a little less of a debate because they see it as not being a particularly big deal.
I just want to add one more thing. This is one of my pet peeves, and that is that we need more rigorous thinking in this. You know, you mentioned curvilinear relationships, for example. A lot of times we think of linear relationships, and maybe there are a few things that are linear related, but like you just said too, implied, you know, a lot of times they're curvilinear. You can have too much of a good thing. Mm-hmm. But there's, and I also mentioned another example of sometimes you have trade-offs between variables, like developmental adversity and psychopathology. But another thing is sometimes people will conflate questions that are actually independent questions and they think they're the same. And this is one of my favorite examples. I actually call it the mad genius paradox. I show there's no reason why you can't have these two things hold simultaneously. One, that creative people have lower mental illness than non-creative people. Two, that the more creative you are, the more tendencies you have towards mental illness. Those two statements are actually independent of each other. You can have mental illness increase with someone's creativity. So the genius at the upper end is more vulnerable than the also-rans at the bottom, okay? But comparing all those people as a whole with non-creatives, you get reverse correlation. And you know why? It's very simple. There's fewer of those people out there. So the average is dominated by the people at the bottom who are still creative, but they're the also-rans.
And the problem is that since that's a complex issue, people assume, oh, well, if geniuses are ill, then all creative people are ill.
And they don't have to be.
That's not true.
They can actually be more mentally healthy than the average person on the street.
And which is what a lot of the stuff we're finding, that at the little C level, mm-hmm. you have better at post-traumatic growth, you have better at a lot of physical health, mental health, coping with stress, all these good things at the little C level. And that, but as a result, you have this anti-creativity bias that has been servicing in the schools and the workplace.
Well, I think a bigger anti-bias is really toward mental illness.
Yeah,
don't argue with that.
And
yeah.
So I think the reason it's important to understand this and think about this is because I think most people think that if they get a mental illness or somebody they love gets a mental illness, that that means that they are doomed to be marginalized and non-functional. And in fact, there can potentially be some strengths in somebody who has mental illness, maybe even having something to do with their mental illness. And the question is, how do we view it differently and help that person to be the best they can be, whatever that might be, whether that means, you know, I think often it does mean treatment, but how can we help them clue in to the ways in which they might be able to be their best selves, let's say, their most creative selves, their most productive selves. So, you know, you can look at it from the creativity end, and as you said, that is why there is a lot of, I think, controversy about this, and also because, you know, people don't always agree on how studies are done and how the statistics out of the studies are used. So that becomes part of the difficulty. Someone asks, are there similar elements, psychological, social, developmental, that are shared by many geniuses?
Oh, boy. There are so
huge
many.
Number. I mean, how about you name the top few?
Great Genius 101. Okay.
Since I'm the series editor,
I guess. Okay, so we talked about creativity. We talked about divergent thoughts and many thoughts. Diligence.
Yeah.
Right.
Innovation. In fact, that 101 is actually the count of the number of factors involved.
Oh. But there are biggies. Motivation and drive.
Openness to experience.
Openness. So flexibility.
Sensible risk taking.
Right. Toss it out there. Drive, motivation, grit. Mm-hmm. Very, very important.
Something that's being looked at much more right now. A lot of research being done at the University of Pennsylvania by Angela Duckworth.
Duckworth, yeah. On, I mean, really good
on
stuff.
On grit and how that makes all the difference in terms of accomplishment.
And the thing is that people don't realize that sometimes we think it's too easy. You know, this is one of the myths of genius. You know, the geniuses just come up with these ideas and it's really easy for them. It is not. You know, Albert Einstein, for example, he had to go do lots of hard work, trial and error, false runs with his special theory of relativity, his general theory of relativity. But what I think is really more remarkable is a lot of people don't realize he spent the last 30 years of his life ramming his head against a brick wall.
Literally?
Well, not literally.
Sorry.
He actually had a different metaphor. He says, I keep on having infants being born and they immediately go into the graveyard. That was the metaphor he used. And he was trying to develop a unified field theory that would unify all the forces of nature. And people go ahead and say, but he wasn't using quantum theory, and probably maybe a unified theory wouldn't work without quantum theory. But the fact is, Albert Einstein thought he had already disproved quantum theory. So it was a perfectly reasonable enterprise for him to engage in. And he had the grit to waste 30 years of his life on it. On his deathbed, he asked for his notes so he'd get one last chance to look at them to see if he could finally figure it out.
I think one thing that's, last year we had a discussion about genius and where does it come from, and the panel really talked about the fact that messiness in the brain is hugely important. And then enough neatness in the brain to be able to take that mess and bring it to fruition. And so, you know, to some degree, the issue with illness is, you know, it's brain messiness, right? Things are not moving in the way that you would normally expect. And so it's that back and forth between, you know, sort of disinhibited thinking and this flexibility of thinking, and then being rule-bound enough to and driven enough and motivated enough to bring it to fruition. How do you think fame affects genius?
There is some data on that. Some research on Nobel Prize recipients has shown that they have a little dip. in their output. But of course, part of that is, what?
They're so old by the time they get the
Yeah, map. They're so old by the time they get it.
But you also have the Oscar curse. I mean,
yeah.
You know, you have dips after any great peak.
Right. I mean, but you get so much attention. All of a sudden, you're getting all these invitations to give talks and write articles on your work, you know, for popular magazines. And so it's really hard to spread it out. There is some research, like Herod Zuckerberg, just down the street, did some interesting stuff on Nobel laureates and American scientists, and found that every Nobel laureate did, or not everyone, that's an extreme statement, but it was very likely that Nobel laureates did at least one other thing that was worthy of a Nobel Prize after getting the Nobel Prize. But there was this dip, this little delay when they get distracted by fame and fortune.
Well, a lot of the work is done in earlier years when, you know, thinking is sort of, you know, in the 20s when you might be at your peak to some degree of the creative thinking process.
Certainly if you look at novel problem solving, it starts declining around 19, which really sad. Is
amazing. So if you're talking about the maths or the sciences, right, you 19. At 19.
Is when it begins to decline.
When it begins to
but
decline.
What does that mean? I mean, we're just thinking about Andrew Wiles was in his 40s.
You can start here and it can decline. You can still be incredibly high.
Yeah, maybe he wouldn't have made that mistake if he was 25.
Yeah. And you also need that acquired knowledge, which thankfully stays constant.
Yes.
Until you're about 60.
Yes.
And a cruise, right?
Yeah.
The other point about fame is that often when people become famous, right, they develop what's called acquired narcissism. Right? People are around them and saying, you are fantastic, everything you do is fantastic. And that can be an impediment to the hard work and determination required to continue to.
And it also can lead to drug or alcohol abuse. There was a very interesting study that looked at people and actually measured, looked at, for example, the lyrics of Kurt Cobain, and actually measured the shifts in his pronoun usage. From you to me and I.
Wow, that's interesting.
Okay, and as he became more famous, as measured by how many reviews the stuff got, he started changing this pronoun, becoming much more self-centered. Okay, and the end result, of course, is he ended up committing suicide. It was too much for him. Another person in the sample was John Cleaver, and in his case, it was amazing. Not only could they measure his first person usage, but he kept a record of how much he drank, a diary of his drinking habits as he wrote. And as he became more and more famous, he started drinking more and more and more. And then that had a detrimental effect on his creativity.
Well, we do know that a number of artists in particular, substance abuse was essentially their mental illness, or at least one of them.
Right.
And you know, obviously, in the extreme of substance abuse, it kills productivity.
Right.
But before the extreme, is there some correlation with?
There's been a lot of studies on this. Mm-hmm. There's almost no association.
No
People
association.
Think they're being more creative. They're not.
So they just think they're being more creative.
Well, it's like this study that was done of jazz musicians, where they did this really nice improvisation two ways: one when they're high, and one when they weren't. They asked them to evaluate their performance, and of course, the one they picked as the best one was when they were high, but when they had them listen to the tape recordings, they picked the one where they weren't high.
What would you say about John Lennon?
Huh? I mean, are you, John, that's to him or me?
Yeah, what?
In terms of being more creative with drug use?
Yes.
Or, I've always preferred the Beatles before.
Okay.
I'm one of the geeky people who preferred Paul, so.
All right, so someone asks that we've been using the term genius applied to artists, to like a Lincoln, political genius, but is there a genius in the emotional intelligence and social skills realm? Would we call anyone a genius because they are so skilled in that way? Or really, are we talking about leaders?
I mean, I think somebody like a Gandhi or a Mother Teresa,
yeah.
I would feel comfortable.
Yeah, that's a good example.
Genius, mm-hmm. But it's also that they applied it. if they were just amazingly emotionally intelligent and just stayed in the house, then I probably wouldn't call.
What about somebody like Stalin, who was beloved?
I mean, yeah, genius doesn't have to mean good. I mean, Hitler would have been a hell of a baseball manager. I mean, he could motivate people.
Yeah.
I mean, emotional intelligence doesn't mean being a good person. It means being able to manipulate and know people's emotions, and you can be a genius at that and be pretty bad.
Yeah.
Do most geniuses find themselves introverted, extroverted? Is this something that drives their madness?
Well, first of all, introversion tends to be strongly associated, but it does depend on the kind of creativity or actually kind of achievement that we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Because in some areas, extroversion is in fact very handy and useful and even mandatory.
I mean, performance business.
Yeah, performance, you know, being a choreographer, director, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Stanley Kubrick was very, very introverted. But that shows, because he had a very low output of films.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And drove people crazy. Yeah.
But in your research, you haven't found a propensity toward a specific field and whether they're introverted or extroverted.
Well, part of that, can I say something? Introversion, extroversion is a very complex construct. There's actually two components to it, and they often split in people.
Mm-hmm.
There is your social dominance component, how much you like to influence people. And that's obviously associated with leadership, okay? And then there's the social affiliation component, how much you like to be with people versus dominate. And that is not associated with being a great leader. There's a lot of leaders that are extremely introverted as far as not wanting to be with people. But they are socially dominant, because the second they walk in the room, everybody has to follow them.
Mm-hmm. We're out of time.
Oh.
But I know, that went by really, really quickly. But hopefully, you're continuing your research. You're continuing your research. Are you writing about?
I'm writing about Cold War spies.
Okay. Well, that sounds pretty.
Well, they're all new.
So we would like to know if there are any genius spies coming up. There'll be some book signing afterwards, right? So if you would like to, if you're interested in what these people have written, which you should be because it's pretty fascinating, they'll be outside. But we look forward to perhaps reconvening with some future information about this subject. I think it's really important. But thank you very much for coming.